So what I'd like to do today is to lead you through a journey over time and space that started thousands of years ago. And that is not over yet. But don't worry, because I'll try to concentrate on the short part of the journey that I had the privilege to be part of. And that led us to start thinking of genetically engineered lymphocytes as living drugs to fight cancer. So if we think at the therapy for cancer in the future as a column that sustains our health, I see it made of regular bricks, the anti-cancer drugs, but I see it also made of living drugs, the living figures here, the caryatides. And I think that these living drugs will be genetically engineered lymphocytes. I'm going to be helped today in this presentation by artistic masterpieces, sometimes selected and sometimes created for this event by high school students of the Liceo Artistico Fondazione Sacro Cuore in Milan. Let's start. I don't know exactly where or when the journey started, but I'd like to think it started in ancient Greece, thousands of years ago. Thucydides, in the history of the Peloponnesian War, describes the plague of Athens. This is an infection, very aggressive, that killed almost half of the population in Athens and possibly changed the fate of the war. And interestingly, Thucydides reports that the very few patients who survived the infection could safely take care of the ill, since the same man was never attacked twice from that disease. Unfortunately, we cannot say the same for most cancers. Today, we know that this immunity described by Thucydides is due to immunological memory and is mediated by lymphocytes, cells of our immune system present in our body. How does that work and how can we use it to fight cancer? Our body produces billions of T lymphocytes, and they're all different. Every T lymphocyte, it protects us from a pathogen thanks to a receptor named T-cell receptor. So we have T-cells specific for flu, T-cells specific for measles, and so on. And nature actually protects us also from the unknown. We even have T-cells specific for pathogen that do not exist yet, that might develop in the future. So we might think of T-lymphocytes as a sort of a comfortable, waterproof raincoat that is ready to protect us from every environment, every pathogen that we might encounter in life. And what happens when we get an infection? For example, we're infected by measles. Then our measles-specific T lymphocytes finally see their enemy, their antigen, their virus, and they start to proliferate. They'll create an army of measles-specific T lymphocytes able to fight the virus. And once we have recovered, most of these lymphocytes will die. Only a few will survive. And these few surviving cells will never be the same. The encounter of the lymphocyte with the antigen will leave a mark on the lymphocyte, like a footprint. It will change. And these few surviving lymphocytes, each one marked by the encounter with its own antigen, will persist for decades and will now be a memory lymphocyte, able to fight that same virus with much more efficiency, so ensuring that we shall not get sick again for that virus. So it took thousands of years to really understand the observation of Thucydides. But the question here today is, how can we use this observation to fight cancer? Can we obtain memory lymphocytes able to fight cancer? Now, the only lymphocytes, rare and lazy, dysfunctional in our body, are lymphocytes that react against parts of our body. They are perceived like revolutionary rebels that could actually attack parts of our body itself. So they're eliminated, they're tamed. And since cancer arises from our body, then T lymphocytes specific for cancers are really rare. Cancer cells have a lot of properties. I'm not going to enter in details. There are cells that evolve in time. But one property I want to highlight, the cancer cells are able to avoid destruction by our immune system, so by the lymphocytes. So T lymphocytes have the potential to fight cancer, but they're not enough. We need to help them. And today, we have the technological tools required to modify the DNA of T lymphocytes. We can genetically engineer the DNA of T lymphocytes. What does that mean? Well, we can use viruses, viral vectors, as Trojan horses to drive genes into the DNA of T lymphocytes. And these genes, this new information, will impose a new function. For example, specificity for cancer. That's something we can do today. But when I started at the beginning of the 90s, this field, the gene therapy field, was really at its dawn. I was then a medical student in Milano. I wanted to be a hematologist, take care of patients with leukemia. But I was also fascinated by immunology and by genetics. And one day, I heard a seminar from an enthusiastic, a pioneering scientist, Claudio Bordignon. And he had just infused the first genetically engineered stem cells to a patient with a genetic disease. And believe me, in those 2 hours of lesson, I understood clearly and with no doubts that that was the path I wanted to take. And I started. So Claudio sent me for a few months at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York to learn about hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. This is a treatment for leukemia, a cancer of the blood. And there I learned that lymphocytes present in a subject can kill leukemia growing in a different subject. But unfortunately, these same lymphocytes can also recognize healthy tissues of the patient and lead to a life-threatening toxicity. So back in Milano, in San Raffaele, my project, my first project was to insert a gene into these lymphocytes, in the DNA of these lymphocytes, that could allow us to kill the lymphocytes and control the toxicity. It's named a suicide gene. I was thrilled, but I had no idea how to do this. Fortunately, in a research lab, you're never alone, and I was not alone. So I met Katia Traversari, who taught me everything I should know about lymphocytes. Then I learned from Giuliana Ferrari and Fulvio Maviglio how to build a viral vector. And there we were, the first vector was there. We built it, and we built the virus, and use it to genetically engineer lymphocytes. And then these engineered lymphocytes could be infused to patients with leukemia receiving transplantation. It was a great beginning. And we learned even more when Fabio Ciceri, a knowledgeable and generous hemato-oncologist, joined the project. And there we learned that when we infuse genetically engineered lymphocytes to a patient with leukemia, sometimes leukemia can be killed. And that we can always control toxicity thanks to the suicide gene we have inserted. And today, a clinical trial, a registration trial, is ongoing in the US and in Europe with these first genetically engineered lymphocytes. And then I got married. You can really not make a journey without a soulmate who's ready to wish to make the journey with you, to share the journey with you. My husband is a medical doctor, and he takes care of patients with, guess what, infections, viruses again. And we moved to Seattle, where we succeeded in fishing salmons, and that was something. But we also learned much more about lymphocytes and cancer at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center, and I really hope we'll never stop traveling together with our wonderful kids. But back to science, and back in San Raffaele, we still had a question. Will the genetically engineered lymphocytes persist long-term? And which is the subset of lymphocytes able to persist long-term to mediate the potent immunological memory that we talked about? I said at the beginning, when a lymphocyte encounters the antigen for the first time, it changes. It undergoes multiple phases, can become a effector, central memory, effector memory, even memory stem T cells, a newly discovered subset. And we've learned to engineer each of these subsets. But the question is, which is the subset able to persist long-term in patients? Fortunately, Giacomo Oliveira and Nicoletta Ceri joined the lab and the journey as PhD students and took care of this question. It is not a trivial question, because our body continues to produce lymphocytes throughout life. So when we study a lymphocyte, we never know when it was generated. One day before, a decade before, we don't know. But we realized that by studying patients undergoing gene therapy, we could answer that question. Because the engineered lymphocytes, the green one here, can be distinguished from all others because of the gene we have inserted. They are barcoded cells. So we concentrated on 10 patients with leukemia who had been treated with transplantation and genetically engineered lymphocytes. The patients were all alive and well, with no leukemia, from 2 to 14 years after treatment. And Giacomo looked at the genetically engineered lymphocytes and found thousands of cells still present in the treated patients years after treatment. And then we went back and looked and tried to trace their origin. And what we discovered in this study was that those lymphocytes were memory stem T cells at the time of infusion, were the one that had expanded more and persisted more in patients. So they appear to be the one we want to engineer to prepare a living drug for cancer patients. But what is really the gene we want to insert in these memory lymphocytes? Can we make memory lymphocytes specific for cancer cells by genetic engineering? Today, we can even build new genes. We can take portions of a cancer-specific antibody and portion of T-cell receptor, make them together, and build a CAR, chimeric antigen receptor. And CAR T-cells will recognize molecules present on the surface outside the cancer cells and kill cancer cells. But when we want to kill a cancer cell and spare the normal cells, we need to find differences between cancer and normal. And sometimes differences are not on the surface of the cancer cells. They're hidden. They're hidden inside the cancer cells, the green dot here. And CAR T cells will not see these hidden differences, while on the contrary, T cell receptors do. And that's why for some tumors, we might want to use TCR to engineer lymphocytes instead of CARs. And that's what I want to do. But look at what happens. When I try to engineer a lymphocyte, now you know how it is made, with a tumor-specific T-cell receptor, the green one here, I'll end up with lymphocytes that have now two TCR. The one that was still present, was already present before engineering, and the green one, the one that I have introduced. This non-physiological condition might create a conflict for the cells. Think at computer. It's like when you have two conflicting programs in your computer. What happens? The computer freezes. It doesn't work well. So the same is with engineered lymphocytes. Conflicting information might lead to reduced efficiency and even to toxicity. So here we have a problem. The gene therapy, first-generation gene therapy, is not enough. Scientists have always problems to solve. That's our life. And we need to be curious people, because most of the time we find a solution looking at science at a different scientific field. I actually found the inspiration for the solution to this project hearing a lecture that was not on cancer. It was on HIV. And it described the genome editing technology. This is a potent technology. It was based on zinc finger nucleases. How do they work? They are molecular scissors. They bind DNA, they bind a gene that we select, that we choose. And once they bind, a scissor cut, so they cut DNA. And they disrupt the gene that we have chosen to disrupt. So the genome editing technology allows, instead of just adding a gene, to take away one gene that we don't want and substitute it with the one that we want. It's the, I would say, the cut and paste tool for DNA. So with this new technology, I started a new project with a lot of colleagues in Italy, in Seattle, in California. That's how science is done today. We work together. And we developed the last project I'm going to summarize, which is the TCR gene editing project. We started from lymphocytes and disrupted the gene for the endogenous T cell receptor with our molecular scissors, the zinc finger nucleases, and substituted this gene with genes encoding for the tumor-specific T cell receptor. Now, this receptor is expressed at high levels alone, and these lymphocytes have no conflicts. The edited lymphocytes now, at least in the lab, since these cells have not been used in patients yet, now they can recognize very well leukemia cells, cancer cells, and kill them. So, is the journey over? Of course not. It's a long journey, as I anticipated, and we really have several challenges to face. We need to personalize this therapy. We need to find TCR, multiple TCR receptor for each cancer type. We need to take care of the regulatory framework for this new class of drugs. Sustainable costs, automation. We have really a lot of challenges to face. But I am optimistic, because I really believe that this is a real hope for cancer. I believe that in the near future, the therapy for cancer will include the infusion of genetically engineered T lymphocytes that will act as an army of living drugs, able to see and kill the cancer cells, but also to persist in the patients, patrolling the organism for tumor recurrence. And the other reason why I'm optimistic is because I'm not going to face this journey alone, as you probably have guessed up to now. I will share it with doctors, scientists, volunteers, people working in funding agencies, in disease association, in academia, in biotechs, and most importantly, by a bright generation of new students who are inspired by the quest for science and are ready to embark on the journey with us. Thank you.